I'm going to call.
You got what?
Somebody using.
What was the problem?
Maybe somebody still outside.
So the idea is to look to the long-term rotation motion of bodies. So it could be the Earth, like here, or it could be an asteroid, it could be any kind of body. And so the thing I would say I want to try, we will see how it goes, because I have not a very precise schedule in mind, but there are a few things. I want to really do the work in order to, at the end, understand what I'm showing here, which is the precession motion of the Earth. So you see, so I can put the motion on. So, and there is a problem here, just it's rotating the reverse way, because I switched my computers, and this is an old version where the precession is in the wrong way, but it doesn't matter. So you have the precession of the spin axis of the Earth. If you see well, you have also some oscillation of the spin axis. I'll stop here the precession so you can see it better. And you see here the small oscillation of the spin axis. And this is due to the planetary perturbation. And the thing is, you see there is the moon here. And if I remove the moon, the spin axis of the Earth becomes chaotic and with very large variation. And if I put it back, it's blocked again. So that's the question, why, what is all that? And this is what I want to do now. So, and I will do it in this one. I will try to do it in a very, I assume that this is a lecture, so I am trying to write everything. And writing the equation, and to give the framework of what is the useful framework for studying this kind of problem. And by doing that, it's not, doesn't apply only on for the Earth and the Moon. It can apply to any rigid body, of course. The problem is to okay. I will just have to. I assume just a basic knowledge about rigid body from the beginning, but still I have to give some notation. So usually, I will. This is very small, but if I do it bigger, it will. So I will have a fixed reference frame with small letter, and I will have a moving reference frame with big letter. And a solid is linked to this reference frame. So what we can define for a solid, we have the coordinate in the fixed reference frame that are obtained from the coordinate in the fixed reference, in the rotating reference frame by a rotation. This is a good definition. Here we assume a fixed point. We don't put translation motion. And when you derivate, so this is what you obtain. But of course, here, these are the coordinates in the reference frame related to the solid, and the definition of the solid is in fact that these coordinates don't move. With respect to the frame of the solid, a point doesn't move in the solid. So this is zero, and we just have this Q, but Q is R minus 1 Q, and this defines. So here you have the relation between the derivative in the fixed frame of the position for the motion of the solid. And you can easily show that this is antisymmetric, and it's an antisymmetric matrix of dimension 3. So you can say that this is omega vector Q, where omega is a vector, and this is the instantaneous axis of rotation of the solid. So, of course, this is well known, and then you want to compute. What you want to compute is to want to compute the quantity the momentum of the solid, the angular momentum of the solid, and you can I will not go back on that, but when you look to the clock, this clock is on, is okay?
Yes.
Okay. Yes, maybe I can. It's all the point whether you need to explain everything, or whether you everybody this is something that is known by everybody and you should go very quick on that, but then most of people are lost. maybe I can still give a little bit of hint. So when you want to compute the angle, but the thing is, for me, I know that people who work in the solid rotation or in the solid, for example, people who work in the motion of the Earth, they always put themselves in the reference frame linked to the Earth. I hate that. I don't like moving reference because it's also the problem when you want to look to additional perturbation. It's always troublesome. I prefer to stay on a fixed reference frame here and to compute everything in this reference frame. Okay, but the angular momentum, so what is the angular momentum of the solid? Well, you know what it is. You just take the elementary angular momentum and you sum them. And when you sum them, so this gives Q omega vectorial Q dm. This is it. But here you have a problem, because these coordinates are related to the fixed reference frame. So you will not be able to do much. When you want to integrate over the solid, you want to integrate over the reference frame of the solid. But it's quite easy, because the transformation, when you have a vectorial product, how does it go by your rotation? the rotation of this is just RU, RV. So you can very easily change everything to the reference frame of the solid, and you will have the expression. When I put G, it will be in the reference frame of the solid. It will be the same formula, but now with the coordinate in the reference frame of the solid. So here you make an integration over the solid. So you can do it easily. And so you can just have to express the double vectorial product, so it will be qg omega minus q omega g. And this is the problem of, so it will be qq omega minus q omega q. And this, this you want to write in another way. You want to have omega each time, so this is fine. You want to extract things that are, so here you will put just, you will write it the other way, q omega. And so I will write it like that. This will be, so it will be trans. I write it in a vectorial, in a matrix form. So it's transpose of Q omega time Q. And Q omega Q suddenly I'm confused, but
to define the moment of inertia.
Yes, that's all what I want to do, but I'm just trying to wake up. And
take your time.
And suddenly I don't see why I can write this as a QQ trans. Oh yes, no.
It's Q omega Q is a QQ transpose omega.
What Q? Oh,
omega
this
Q.
One. This one I can
Q?
Change.
Yes.
This
yes.
One I can change. This is all right. It's this one that I can change as omega transpose Q. No.
Q transpose omega.
Say it.
Q transpose.
Here, Q transpose omega. Yes, this is what I want to write, but. Why? This is this.
Omega is a vector.
This
so you
is
don't care about
this is a vector, yes. I have a vector like that, a vector like that, and a vector like that. Okay. And I can exchange these two. I can say that it's omega transpose Q, but that's and I can find the transpose of everything. Yeah, I think that the Q transpose Q identity minus Q transpose, so it's the integral of this. So, and this is, so they here, you now integrate only over the solid, and this is what you will call the momentum of inertia of the solid. So you have the fact that the angular momentum in the frame of the solid is a matrix depending on the solid, and it's a symmetric matrix time omega. So once you have that, as it is a symmetric matrix, you can find a reference frame, you can diagonalize it in an orthogonal reference frame, and you will have the form of the matrix in the reference frame linked to the solid. So this is what you will use now. So this is for the angular momentum, and so the angular momentum will be A omega 1, B omega 2, and C omega 3. And then you want to write the kinetic energy, because we are looking to the free motion of the solid. You want to write the Hamiltonian, so you need the kinetic energy. And in the same way, the kinetic energy, the double or the kinetic energy, will be one half of Q dot dm. And if you make the same kind of computation, you will find that 2t equal g omega, and it's that say equal to here you have it easily, so it will be A omega 1 square plus B omega 2 square plus C omega 3 square. So and usually then you will say you want to write down the equation, so you have two things that are concerned. Okay, you have the kinetic energy here, and you have the angular momentum, but of course the angular momentum and what you want to do is to integrate this problem, but so the classic thing to do is then to write the conservation of the angular momentum, which is g, you have g equal rg. What is conserved is the angular momentum in the fixed reference frame, so you derivate this, and this will be r dot g plus G plus R G dot. And so R dot G, this will be omega vectorial G plus R G dot, and this will be thus same thing. You say that it's a rotation of omega vectorial G plus R G dot, which is just R omega vectorial G plus G dot. So you know that this is zero, which means that as this is a rotation, this is zero, and you have G dot equal G vectorial omega, and this is a Euler equation. So this is usually, you know, the thing is that you have a nice expression of the equation of motion in the reference frame related to the solid. And this is what is usually made when you learn in the first school of university. You learn that because it goes well. You can write it down, and you have a nice expression. And then you write, so you write this in, you express them easily. You see G as a very simple expression, this one, A omega 1, B omega 2, C omega 3. Omega is just omega 1, omega 2, omega 3. And you write just the vectorial product, and these are the three Euler equation. So that's nice. But and we have two. So the when you look to the Euler equation, or maybe I can write them down. So G dot will be A omega 1 dot, and this will be, so let me write it down. It will be B omega 2 C omega 3. So it will be omega 2 omega 3, so C omega 2 omega 3 minus B omega 2 omega 3, so C minus B omega 2 omega 3, and this following one, B equal, so B, it will be A minus C omega 1 omega 3, and C omega 3 dot equal C minus B minus A omega 1 omega 2. So you have this expression A, B. Okay. So these are the Euler equation, and you have one integral of motion here, and another integral of motion, which is just to say that the modulus of J is constant, because we know that, we only know that J is constant in the fixed reference frame, but as it's a rotation that goes to the solid, you don't have J constant in the solid, of course, if you have this equation, but the norm is constant. So you have, this will be equal to omega 2 plus omega 1 square plus omega 2 square plus omega 3 square. So you have a system of order 3 with two integrals, and you have integrability, and you can write the solution. You know that there are solutions, you can write them, but it's difficult. It's not easy. You can look to a good reference, I know, the Landau-Lipschitz book, for example. It's written in quite detail. And or Arnold, but no, it's more written, it's more in the Landau-Lipschitz, that you have the detail of the of the solution. It's a complicated solution with elliptical function and all these kind of things. But, and you can make easily the analysis of stability of the various positions, but it's not what that I want to take about that. I assume that you are familiar already with that. But just by looking to the surface of the to the integral surface in the phase space, you know what is the stability of the. You see, you can make this kind of plot. This you are probably familiar with. The thing I want to stress is here. You have written the equation of motion of the. You have written the equation of motion in the reference frame linked to the solid, but you don't have the solution of the motion of the solid in the fixed reference frame. It's not you don't have that yet. You have to go from one to the other one. So. When you, for example, when you have a perturbation, when you have anything, then you want to have things in the fixed reference frame. And so the classical way to do that is then to use the relation between the two reference frames using the first thing is Euler angle. So this is what I will look to, but as I have... I will make a better picture here. We need a nice picture. Okay, so Euler angle, and you have your solid. So you will, here it will be like, do we have color? No. I should have asked for color.
I can bring the colors.
Ah, thanks. I didn't, okay, anyway. So you see here it is unequal. So this is BK, big I, big J, little I, little G, little K. And we will have, so we will define the position of the solid by three rotation. This one, so you have a rotation. A rotation around K, I call it 3. So R3 of theta is the rotation against the third angle, so it's just cosine theta minus sine theta, cosine theta, 0, 0, 1. And same thing for the other one, it's the rotational matrix. Rotation 3 of psi, rotation 1, then we arrive here, and I call this one U. We arrive here, you rotate by epsilon around the first axis, and then you rotate by theta around the third axis. So, the coordinate of a vector in the fixed reference frame is equal to the coordinate in the solid body reference frame through this product of rotation. I want to write the Hamiltonian of the system in the fixed reference frame. So I will have to use this variable. This will be, these angles are the phase, are the phase coordinate of my body. The body is my solid body is perfectly determined once I have provided this coordinate. So I know I can write the equation of motion. I will have to write the Lagrangian, and I will be able to write down the equation in the fixed reference frame. So in order to write the Lagrangian, I have to compute. Here we don't have any potential. We have just the only energy is the free motion, so it's a kinetic energy. So I have to write down the kinetic energy, and the kinetic energy, I know what it is. It is, so 2t equal g omega. So the only thing I have to compute is I know how to compute omega and g in the everything in the reference frame related to the solid. So the only thing I have to compute is the the only thing I have to compute are the in fact the omega the omega, the instantaneous rotation velocity in the reference frame related to the solid. And so this is done classically. In fact, you can write this by sphere rotation. You will just write here, I should put this one. This one is my intermediate vector u, and I have for this to be more clear, I have. Made, but maybe I should not do give it to you now, maybe later. It's just because now it's still relatively simple. And so I will write the instantaneous angular velocity. You have that omega is equal, maybe I should put that for the answer for the vector. It will be, so I just, you just write the sum of the three angular velocity. I don't demonstrate that this is like that, but you can think that it is it's valid, that it is this rotation vector plus this rotation vector, so it will be plus epsilon u plus the other one, theta dot, k. And what you have to do, if you want to use all this, you have to write everything in the reference frame of the solid. So this one is okay. And you have to write the two other ones in the reference frame of the solid. Okay, so you have to just to compose the rotation and to be able to do it. What time do we have?
Say 50 minutes.
How much?
Yes, after 10:20 we make a little break.
We started at
9:30.
So sharp. Did we start at 9:30? Yes. And now it's 10.
Yes.
And we stop at
10:04, and we stop at 10:20. We make a little break, and then we start again.
Okay. that will be fine.
Unless you want to skip the break, but.
So you see the point. You write here the angular velocity, and then you want to compute the kinetic energy. So you have to write everything. You need to be able to handle everything you need to put everything in the reference frame linked to the solid, where it's in the reference frame where everything is written in a simple way. Rotation are always tricky. You never know in which way you make the rotation. So the way I usually, for example, if I want, I know how to write. This is a transformation from the fixed reference frame to the solid reference frame. If you want to write the transformation, I know only how to write it that way. Then to write it the other way, you just invert this. That's sufficiently easy. So if you want to write this in the, you will have to put the inverse rotation to write it in the solid reference frame. It will be, you will need to make, so it's k, you need to make all the rotation in reverse. And it will, the first one will not do anything, so it will be R3 of minus theta, and then R1 of minus epsilon, and then the other one will not do anything, so it will be k. Should be like that, because this one doesn't affect this one, so plus epsilon dot u, and u you put it in the other way, so there is just one rotation u, and then plus theta dot k. So when you write it like that, everything is written in the good reference frame. And you obtain, I will just write it. My goal here will be mainly to show you that in Euler coordinates, things are complicated. But, so if you do that, you will obtain, so psi sinus theta sinus epsilon plus epsilon dot cosinus theta, and then psi dot cosine theta sinus epsilon minus epsilon dot sin theta, and then psi dot cosine epsilon plus theta dot. So these are omega 1, omega 2, omega 3, which is just obtained here. I should not put k here, I should put just 0, 0, 1, and here the same thing. Okay, so with this, you can write now the kinetic energy, which is written here. And this is what you need. You need this to write the Lagrangian, which is here. And you don't have any potential. It's the same thing as the kinetic energy. So you will have L equal T. So this is just A.
you have to square this, so it will be this square times A plus this square times B plus this square times C. So this will be this. And so if you write it down, you in fact, I don't even, you see, you have a relatively, I don't have to write it again, it's exactly this, A times D squared plus B times D squared plus C times D squared. It's something that is complicated. It simplifies if A equal B. If A equal B, because you have this square, you see the double product cancel. You have this square plus this square, so that makes epsilon dot square. So everything simplifies if A equal B. So this is why in all textbooks, you immediately make the assumption A equal B. But if you have an asteroid, A is not equal to B. If you have a spacecraft, A is not equal to B. If you have, and even if you have a planet, A is very close to B, but if you want to look to small detail, it's not the case. So, despite, we know that the problem is integrable, we know how to write down the equation, you see that this leads to a very complicated form of the Hamiltonian. And I don't want to write it down because there is really no way you can simplify it. You can, so despite that, you can write the a canonical set of variables. So a canonical set of variables, you will have P, so my first variable is dL over d C dot. This is the, so you can write down what it is. You have to derivate, and for all the other variables like that. If you write that, it's, and if you write, you imagine that it's complicated. I will not write them, and so P theta is dL over d theta dot. Epsilon equals dL over d epsilon dot. It's very complicated when you left it expressed in this coordinate. Of course, what you want to do is, or it simplifies somewhat. I can write them. Maybe I will write them still. I will write them here. So you will get, if you make this computation, you get this. You get P C equal A omega 1, so sine theta sine epsilon plus B omega 2 omega 2 cosine theta sine epsilon plus C omega 3 cosine epsilon, and then P epsilon equal A omega 1 cosine theta minus B omega 2 sine theta, and P theta equal, this is just C omega 3. So you can, now what you want to do is you want to write, so okay, it's complicated, but still it's okay. You want, so this is just by computing this from this expression. And now what you want to do, you want to write the Hamiltonian with respect to the angle action variable. So you have a set of variables which are C epsilon theta and the conjugate variable, the conjugate momentum, P epsilon
p theta. And of course, you want now, here you have your Hamiltonian is written with respect to the angle and their derivative. The these are the conjugate variable, which are not exactly the derivative. If you were writing there, it's complicated expression of the derivative. They are expressed here with respect to the angular momentum component, but you want now to express the full Hamiltonian. And so in order to do that, you have to invert that. If you invert that, you will have A omega 1, B omega 2, and C omega 3 that appear here with respect to the P, to the momentum, and then you will be able to write down the kinetic energy. You see that you can make this inversion because here you have an earlier rotation with theta, and so it's easy to invert, and you have this inversion. So I skip the detail. You have the inversion. A omega 1 is equal to P psi minus P theta cosine theta epsilon sinus theta over sinus epsilon plus P epsilon cosinus theta. B omega 2 is equal to nearly the same thing, so it's the same thing here, cosine theta over sinus epsilon plus P epsilon minus P epsilon sinus theta, and then C omega 3 is equal to P theta. So, okay. So we have everything. We can write the Hamiltonian with respect to the momentum. But again, you see that it will give rise to a very complex expression when A is not equal to B. And I don't want to put A equal B. That will be the main thing here. I don't want to put A equal to B. I want to show that things can be written. And you see, if I take A times square of this, plus b times square of this, if a equal to b, it again simplifies. But if a is not equal to b, nothing simplifies, so you are left with all that. Okay, so this is why, and again, another thing, when you have written the Hamiltonian in this form, you see that the Hamiltonian depends on the three momentum, and it still depends on two angles. So you know that when you want to find what is integrating a problem, if you have a problem that is integrable, what you want to do is you want to find a transformation that transforms your problem in a way that it will immediately be integrable, which means it with the Hamiltonian, the energy depends only on the action. This is what we do with the Kepler problem. The Kepler problem is complicated, but when you go to elliptical elements and canonical elliptical elements, like the Delaunay variable, the energy depends only on the semi-major axis. So you are left at the end, or instead of the semi-major axis, you take the canonical variable associated to the semi-major axis, which is the square root, basically, of the semi-major axis, and you are left with an Hamiltonian that depends only on an action, and the integration is trivial. If you have an Hamiltonian that depends only on the action variable, the equation, and not on the angle. Normally, you know, you have an Hamiltonian that depends, a general Hamiltonian will depend on n action and n angle. But if it is integrable, you can find a transformation that will make it depend on only the action. And then the integration of this one, will have some associated variable phi, will be just, so here you go from A theta to G phi. And the solution, you will have d g k over dt equal dh over d phi minus here k, and this is zero. So the action are constant. And for the angle, d phi k over dt equal dh over d g k. But this is constant because it depends only on the gk. So you have constant angle velocity and constant action. So you have a motion that is uniform. You have just phi k equal, so that's nu k t plus phi k 0. And gk equal gk 0 equal constant. This is achieved in the Kepler problem by going to elliptical element. You are just left with a Hamiltonian that depends on the semi-major axis. And the associated angle is the mean anomaly. And the derivative of the mean anomaly is the mean motion, which is constant. So you have, and the mean anomaly goes linearly with the mean motion. So when you do that, you have found some adapted variables that really integrate your problem. In this case, we are very far from that. Because when we write everything using the Euler angle, you are left with an Hamiltonian that depends. It depends on what? It depends on all the action, P phi, P epsilon, P theta. But it still depends on epsilon and theta. So it still depends on two angles. And you don't, by looking to it, you don't already know that it's integrable. And you have no simple way to integrate it. So this is why we will do something else. And this something else is going to Andoyer variable.
Shall we take the break now? 5 minutes, two or 3 minutes. See the good point?
Yeah, maybe up to 10:30. Is that right?
Okay.
Even less.
What?
Even less.
Even less. Okay, just 5 minutes. Right? Maybe, yeah.
Take your time.
Yeah, because it can be a good break now.
Okay.
So you have a clear message for this first part. The message is that is the rigid body is integrable. You know it by Euler equation that you find it. Euler equation. You have Euler equation with two integral of motion, the angular momentum and the kinetic energy. Everything is expressed nicely in the reference frame related to the solid body. But when you want to study perturbation, you need to go to the fixed reference frame. And in this case, when you use Euler angle, you have an expression of the Hamiltonian in canonical variable. But these variables are complicated because they don't show you that the problem is integrable. And you still have two angles, which means that without doing anything, you will think that the motion is 2 degrees of freedom still. And it's complicated. So we want now, we will not be able to do anything in this with these variables. So we want to go to a set of variables which is more adapted. And this will be the Andoyer variable, which I will. And with Andoyer variable, I show you some kind of technical computation here, but with Andoyer variable, everything will get more simple. So with less computation. Okay.